terms of lectures. So I hope that all of you will come to our next lecture as well. We have more, which is great. Take advantage of what's coming as well as what we have. This evening's lecture I'm very much looking forward to. But before I do my part of the introduction, I want to point out that, you know, we have a wealth of riches here. Alberto Perez Gomez is returning for the second of his two lectures. And that will be Monday from 11 to 12:30. And the title of his lecture, Built Upon Love, Architectural Longing, After Ethics and Aesthetics. So, if that's not provocative enough for you, right? So.
And it's not in this room, though.
No, it is in this room.
Yeah, it's in this room.
So it is not feeling longing.
Yes, we don't want it to feel longing. Then it truly will be architectural longing. So this evening is the Don Schlegel lecture in architecture, and it appears that Don isn't here this evening, although he often comes and he's probably still at RMKM drafting some detail and has forgotten, no doubt. Don Schlegel was a professor of architecture for 40 years and was a major figure in the growth and development of the program. He began his career at UNM in 1954 as an assistant professor, guided the program from a Department of Architectural Engineering to a Department of Architecture, and finally into the School of Architecture and Planning. Under his leadership, the architecture program received accreditation from the National Architectural Accrediting Board. He received his Bachelor of Architecture from the University of Cincinnati and his Master of Architecture from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, sometimes known as MIT. His teaching experience was, he started back at the University of Kansas, went to the University of Hawaii, and then came to UNM and retired in 1994. So, as I mentioned to Nicholas earlier, I think Don is most famously known for telling architecture students who were not doing well, or asking them rather, had they not considered a job selling shoes. So, if you ever are asked about your future initiatives, say no. You really want to pursue architecture. So with that, John Pauly will introduce Nicholas.
Oh, Alex, sorry. You'll introduce Nicholas.
Hello. I'm Alex Lev. I'm an assistant professor here in the School of Architecture. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Nicholas to the show tonight. Nicholas is an associate professor of architecture and urban design at the University of California, Berkeley. He received his master's of architecture from Princeton, his bachelor's in art and architectural studies from Yale. He taught architecture at the University of Virginia before moving on to UC Berkeley. He's worked for films such as Diller, Scofidio, and Lemko, and Michael Hopkins and Partners. He's been a visiting researcher at the Santa Fe Institute since 2002. His work has been exhibited at the 2010 Biennale of the Americas, 2012 Venice Architectural Biennale, San Francisco Spur, and SF MoMA. He has been the Daniel Florence Guggenheim Fellow at the Smithsonian Institution, John Dinkeloo Memorial Fellowship at the American Academy in Rome, and he was the winner of the 2012 Rome Prize for Design. While Nicholas's investigations into spacesuits and software may first appear to be disassociated in practice of architecture, they present contradictory notions of space and scale that are frequently overlooked. These investigations are vital for our discipline. And Nicholas is at the vanguard of technology, I'm sorry, is the vanguard of leveraging technology for to produce a clear understanding of who we are and how we behave. So please please join me welcoming Nicholas DeMosha.
Well, it's a great pleasure to be here, and maybe I'll ask before I say anything else if we can get the lights down on the screen so you can hopefully see the slides. Okay, because I don't trust myself just to keep you entertained with my voice. But it's a really great pleasure to be here. I've spent quite a bit of time in New Mexico, but up in Santa Fe. But I'm very excited to be here. John Qualley, your director of architecture, and I were junior faculty together at the University of Virginia, and I will embarrass him ever so slightly, because the University of Virginia is a small school in a town of 20,000 people in the middle of nowhere. People spend a lot of time in the school, and one of the things that it was revealed to me much later that happens is that the students give all of the professors nicknames to encode amongst themselves, and I think mine was something like De Mushmush, to do with the fact that you couldn't pronounce my last name, but John's was Quality. And that tells you a lot about John and about my great respect for John as a teacher and practitioner, and I'm just so delighted to be here and to share him with you tonight. So let me talk about what I'm going to do. So I went to a lot of architecture lectures in architecture school, mostly because the very imperious dean took attendance and would hassle you the next day if you weren't there. And where I went to architecture school in the late 90s on the East Coast, this was the kind of lecture we got. We got the kind of, because I went to Princeton and it was all ostensibly about theory, but not really. You got this kind of intense theoretical discussion about folding and Deleuze or something like that, and then you got a bunch of architectural projects which presumably kind of lived up to the promise of that ideology. So that was the kind of lecture structure. I've noticed that these days the kind of default lecture structure is quite different, because of course there's been a shift in media. We don't have slides. Lectures are much easier to put together, and what usually happens is something like this. You see someone, maybe up until the last minute of the lecture, like throwing all these projects around a giant PowerPoint, and then you get, you know, this kind of almost like foie gras goose feeding of like lots of different images and projects, and you're expected to kind of get something from it. So I'm not going to do that to you. I do work as an architect. I have built projects. I'm not going to show any of them to you tonight. I'm going to show you instead one particular piece of intellectual work that I did, and its relationship, trying to describe its relationship to another piece of a very different kind of work around the design and reconceptualization of architectural software and its possibilities for design. And throughout the lecture, I'm going to go back and forth between showing you actually things I did and then talking about what they might mean. And I'm not would be the last to say that I am the final authority, even on my own work. And so I'd also very much invite you to pay attention. And I'm very happy to even take questions during the lecture, although people are usually way too embarrassed to do that. But I'm most delighted to take your questions at the end. So let's start with space. And by space, I don't actually mean the space that you and I are walking through now, which is the conventional space of architecture, but rather the capital S space. That is actually quite distinct from it. And so it turns out the first person to call space, capital S space, was actually John Milton in Paradise Lost. And he used the capital S space to describe the space very different from the space. Ooh, that's totally embarrassing. Okay. He used the capital S space to describe the space occupied by angels and gods. The space in between worlds was how he put it. And as a result, capital S space has always had a very interesting connotation, which is to say that when it was defined in the early 20th century, it was defined in a much more practical way, which was that capital S space was defined by people like Lovelace here in Albuquerque, but also a whole range of scientists, as very precisely the space that we need technology in order to enter. So So for some of my gloveless doctor, it was the altitude above which you need oxygen or a pressurized environment. For a rocket scientist, it was the altitude above which the atmosphere no longer interfered with thrust. And for a whole range of different kinds of practitioners, it was defined at various altitudes as this space that we need technology in order to enter. And so what we get from it is this very interesting picture of what we get from the conflation of these two ideas, Milton's original idea of the space as this kind of as this heavenly realm, and then this much more 20th century idea about space being a particular kind of environment that we can only enter through technology. Space becomes very precisely the space that we enter with technology and which imbues us with these otherworldly qualities of being of a kind of heroic, transcendental man beyond man. The history of architecture and this relationship and this capital S space is a very complicated one, and I'm just going to talk to you about talk about it with you a very little bit tonight. Lewis Mumford, in his book, The Pentagon of Power, Lewis Mumford, the great architecture, 20th century New Yorker architecture critic and academic and political scientist, he shows this this slide of the astronaut Gus Grissom in a Mercury capsule at the very beginning of his book, Pentagon of Power, and he likens poor Gus to a quote, powerless embryo in the embrace of industry, technology, and the dehumanizing forces of the modern world. I'm going to tell you a slightly different story, but not too distant. Because, of course, the pressurized tower of steel, liquid oxygen, and kerosene on which Grissom ascended into the heavens was very precisely was a couple of different things. It was, number one, the most complicated thing that mankind had ever made up until that point. And number two, it was a repurposed, it was not made originally to lift people into space, but to kill them. It was an Atlas ICBM, and it, like the Titan rocket of Gemini, it was a repurposed ICBM, and the Cold War of the space race, a very tacit substitute for the thermonuclear war that such rockets were designed to wage. These ICBMs were very difficult to make, and so they were actually made in a very new way, one that is very relevant to how we should think about technology and architectural tools today. So to give you a little bit of this, the background of this story, the Air Force, when it wanted to make ICBMs, went about making them as we had made things for tens of thousands of years, which is to say they set out to make it as a single object that served a single purpose. So they, in this case, they hired the Convair Aerospace Company to make them an intercontinental ballistic missile, and that proved to be actually quite difficult because of the sheer complexity of the object. And it's not the first time the complexity of the word I'm going to use a couple of different times tonight. Because of the sheer complexity of this object compared to anything else that had ever been made, way more complicated than a nuclear bomb, it had the tendency, the distressing tendency, to blow up no matter what you did, which is to say that all kinds of unforeseen and unforeseeable interactions between all the different parts, the turbo pump in the rocket engine was the same, rotated at the same frequency as a gyroscope in the nose, and so it blew up. Or there was a resonant frequency between the length of the fuel line and the kind of thrust forces on liftoff, and so it blew up, et cetera, et cetera. And so what had to be created was a very new way of making things. A brigadier general named Bernard Shriver, who was actually wanted originally to be an architect, but grew up during the Depression, so he went into the Air Force instead, along with Simon Ramo and Dean Wooldridge of what would become the defense giant TRW, invented something called systems engineering. And at the time that they invented systems engineering, the word system was so unusual in the English language that they actually had to provide a definition of it in the report to the Joint Chiefs of Staff. They had to say, well, system is something like the solar system or the New York State Railroad system. It's not a thing. It's a whole collection of relationship between things. And if you think about how common this understanding of something that is a system versus an object is in our culture today, versus how unusual it must have been to have to provide a definition in 1950, you have a fundamental sense of the shift in the relationship between technology and objects that happened in the intervening time. So a bunch of things happened. They were successful in making ICBMs, but what they were even more successful in making was what, because the author of this system-oriented approach was fundamentally the president, Dwight Eisenhower, who invested in technology versus the standing army to fight the Cold War, and he created a set of relationships, not just between the different systems of the ICBM, but also between all the different organizations that were constantly researching and designing them, the military, industry, and academia. And it was, of course, Eisenhower who warned, very precisely in his farewell address, of the unwarranted influence of the kind of system that resulted, which he called the military-industrial complex, which he actually wanted to call the military-industrial academic complex, but his speechwriter said that was too long. But so the military-industrial complex was a very vicious thing, because one of the things that that you get when you have a system and not an object is you have, and think about this relative to, again, our everyday lives today, is instead of having a thing that does a job, you have a set of things, each of which can constantly be swapped in and improved, because they're defined not by their nature, but by their relationship to these other things. So your phone, a part of the communication system, is always upgradable. You have an arms race, because different pieces of the ICBM can always be made better. And so you have this ongoing, massive technological enterprise of the military-industrial complex and the arms race. I'm giving you all this context because I am specifically interested in, and I'm going to give you the 5-minute summary of the book I wrote about spacing, so you don't actually have to go out and buy it, but I still encourage you to do so. I became particularly interested in and obsessed with how the human body was designed for in this context. Because if we think about the space as this most extreme environment, Rainer Bannerman, this book, which I would encourage all of you, since you live in the desert, to read, called Scenes in American Deserter, made the fundamental assertion that we learn the most about architecture at its extremes, and the desert being one of them, and space being another. And so what happens to the human body, I asked myself, not only in the extreme landscape of the surface of the moon, the furthest a human body has ever gone, the most extreme environment, but also within the extreme landscape of this military-industrial complex of contractors, academics, researchers, all defined around this notion of systems engineering. And it turns out to be pretty interesting, because the first proposals were to treat the human body precisely like the missile, which is to say, as a set of parts, each of which could be upgraded to better suit the environment of outer space. And this, of course, was the idea of the cyborg. The word cyborg was coined by a team of doctors to describe this idea of the human body swapped out and kind of upgraded part by part. Of course, with the rush into space and the actual complexities of the human body, millions of dollars were spent on this. It was actually a huge expenditure of resources, but because of the pace of the space race as it accelerated with Gagarin's launch, etc., instead of upgrading the human body, a set of environments were designed for the body by military-industrial contractors. These hard, kind of one-piece sort of armored spacesuits on the right, and they were captured the imagination and intelligence of all of the engineers in the space system, but they had a fundamental problem, which is that they didn't work. So what actually happened was something very, very different. The Apollo A7L spacesuit, worn by Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin on the surface of the moon, was not made by a military-industrial contractor, but it was made by what was initially a very small industrial division of the consumer brand of Playtex. And it was made not factories by technicians, but on a shop floor by female seamstresses who had to sew together 21 different layers of fabric to a 64th of an inch tolerance. Instead of being ordered according to serial numbers and systems techniques, it was therefore very much hand-sewn and handcrafted. And for this to happen, of course, all of the other proposals, from the cyborg down to the hard one-piece suit proposals, had to fail, and fail spectacularly, which they did. And the tension between these two different paradigms was very extreme, and we'll give you just two examples of the tension and difficulty between the way in which the suit was made and the way in which everything else was made. First, instead of being sequentially serialized on each modification, as was the systems engineering standard, when you change something in a systems engineering process, you had to distinguish it from this other thing, so you gave it a new serial number, et cetera, et cetera. Each part of the suit, custom fit to each astronaut, was instead sized small, medium, and large, like clothing. Although after an incident with the first astronaut fitted, the urinary collection device was sized large, extra large, and extra, extra large. The second example is more specifically architectural, which is that when it was pointed out in one of the many institutional battles surrounding the paperwork of the suit design process that ILC, the company, was obliged to supply NASA with drawings of the suit design, ILC responded that no drawings were actually used in the suit's making, only patterns and memorized procedures on the part of the seamstresses. This made NASA very upset because, of course, in engineering, you always, as in architecture, you always draw before you make. And so drawings were produced to suit this contractual requirement, but only as the result of a dissection of a suit. So ILC hired a bunch of people to take one of these things apart and then draw it, which produced these beautiful rapidograph drawings of how it was actually made, but these were actually not drawn ahead of the making, they were drawn after. Which is to say that unlike architectural drawings, they are not instruments of inspiration and instructions. They do not predict simplicity, but rather perceive complexity. And in this, I would argue, they share essential qualities with maps of landscapes and particularly of cities. And this is a very down-to-earth point, because what we discover in the heavens is that while technology, whose mediation of our own entrance into capitalized space defines its boundaries, even as it makes us like the gods of old, technology tends to collapse at the boundary of the body in these design processes. And the suit actually has a structure from its kind of epidermal logic here to the kind of soft logic here. It has a logic which is as much has as much in common with the body that it protects as with the kind of super system that it is also, of course, a party. So the kind of intimacy and extension and distortion of this boundary between the body and technology brings us firmly to the subtle nature of media, which is, of course, defined as exactly the thing which comes in between you and something else. The word media comes from the Latin middle element, or lens, and it is a medium is a device that, of course, extends our gaze and allows us to see in the world in a different way, but it also distorts and edits it as well, just like the lenses of my glasses. And the massive system of Apollo had only media as its goal. This television image seen live by more than 500 million people of an American on the surface of the moon. And it is in the continuing influence of the military-industrial mid-century on the media of our own time, and particularly on architectural media, that is my particular interest. But I will give you another example of the continuing influence of the media of the space race in our own time. When the space race started, news broadcasts were only 15 minutes long. And yet, for the Apollo mission, a 24-hour news broadcast had to be invented because no one was interested, at least in the first mission, in watching anything other than Apollo coverage. And a whole new kind of TV needed to be invented from scratch that was adaptable, that involved lots of talking heads and between clips and everything like that. And if this all sounds familiar, that's because the guy who invented it for CBS for the Apollo program, this guy Bob Woosler, actually then went on to co-found CNN with Ted Turner. And we are living very much still in the legacy of the space race in that regard. But what I'm interested in particular, is the continuing influence of this mid-century media on our own craft, that is to say, the makings of buildings, cities, and landscapes. Not just the manifold basic technologies that forge our modern practice of real-time data manipulation and retrieval, networks, sensors, and processors, all fundamentally invented in the context of military-industrial practice, not just these, but actually in a few very specific technologies and techniques with which we perceive and construct cities. This is the very first, one of the very first human interfaces to a real-time computer, the made for a massive air defense system against Soviet bombardment called the Semi-Autonomous Ground Environment, or SAGE. And it was conceived of being so symbiotic with its operator, Shades of the Cyborg, that it actually had a an automotive ashtray and cigarette lighter in the console. Just imagine that in your studio desk. And you know, the really important thing to understand about the history of our media is that every single technology that you sit down and use to conceive of architectural space was fundamentally invented in the context of the military-industrial mid-century, and more often than not was actually conceived of for the space race. So this is the very first three-dimensional environment encountered by human beings on a screen, and it's the part of the Apollo lunar landing simulator that initially was all done with physical models, but then they wanted to, one of the major problems with the space program, with the design of the space program, is that there was no way to practice landing on the moon before you landed on the moon, and our entire national prestige was depending on us doing it. So every single kind of simulation technology, particularly real-time simulation of three-dimensional spaces, had to be invented in order to, in the case of the Apollo astronauts, spend up to 3,000 hours inside of various kinds of simulation in order to experience this thing before the fact. But what is even more interesting is that I don't have to tell you some kind of, wave my hands and tell you some kind of story that you should believe me that all these technologies were, that you use today, were originally conceived of in the space race. What is actually the case is that almost from the moment of their invention, they were immediately repurposed to the design of landscapes and cities. In 1968, in a speech at the Smithsonian, Hubert Humphrey declared that, quote, the techniques that are going to put on the man on the moon are going to be exactly the techniques that we're going to need to clean up our cities. In particular, Humphrey pointed to the systems analysis approach. So something like the lunar landing simulator invented by GE was, by 1966, 3 years before the landing on the moon, already being used in the architecture department at UCLA to design and visualize optimized transportation solutions for downtown LA, complete with piloti and towers in the park and the rest. Joint HUD and NASA had a series of joint meetings and reports about the remaking of cities. With the post, so once we were clearly going to make it to the moon, nobody was interested in Apollo anymore, and a lot of engineers and scientists were let go, and there were summer schools at MIT and Berkeley for the retraining of space engineers for urban administration. The NASA's head of nuclear propulsion research, who designed the spacecraft that Stanley Kubrick used as the model for the Discovery in 2001, he became HUD's first director of research and development, and there masterminded the largest of all of these kind of space-age urbanism programs, something called Operation Breakthrough, which sought to combine aerospace manufacture of prefabricated housing with the very earliest kind of parametric design software to reimagine whole communities from scratch as a kind of product of space race technology. And despite, despite HUD Secretary George Romney, who is Mitt's father, prediction that within 5 years of Operation Breakthrough, 2/3 of all the housing built in this country will be factory made by aerospace companies, by 1976, only one or two of the 22 systems developed, prefabricated housing systems developed by people like Rocketdyne and General Dynamics were actually still being produced. And of the couple of Operation Breakthrough proposals that were actually put into place, there were manifold, and from the perspective of what I started talking about, the difficulty of adapting systems engineering techniques to the body, there are a whole bunch of problems, none of which should actually be surprising, but I'll give you the only most colorful one, which is at the Jersey City Operation Breakthrough site, a pneumatics, a model pneumatic sewage system worked very well, but in reverse. Operation Breakthrough was in fact cited by the General Accounting Office in 1976 for a total failure in its objectives, but maybe a more poetic epitaph is provided by a 1975 NASA study on living and working in space. Drawing on the same space station research exploited by Kubrick's 2001, the proposed habitat would house 10,000 astronauts optimized by age and gender and, quote, settled by persons from Western industrialized nations. In the study, the housing systems of Operation Breakthrough are particularly identified as being suitable for building in space. Here, then, maybe, the components of systems, the systems approach in architecture are seen perhaps in their only native soil, a perfectly managed, balanced utopia entirely, quote, subject to principles from government and industry. So, we've spent a lot of time in space, and maybe it's time to come back to Earth. But the particular way in which I would choose to come back to Earth is by talking about the landscape of systems engineering in an architectural context as fundamentally one of control, of having, of course, its roots in cybernetics, the study of control in large technological and man-made systems. And like any utopia, it is, like the utopia we just saw, it is, like any modern utopia, it is a utopia of transparency. But not a transparency of a visual transparency of glass or a phenomenological transparency of form, but rather a transparency of control. But this utopia is eminently visible at opposite scales of our current urban discourse. On the one hand, in the centralized infrastructure and literal control rooms of so-called smart cities being sold by companies like Samsung, Cisco, and IBM and others, as an inevitable consequence, seemingly inevitable consequence of our increasingly instrumented world. And on the other hand, in the seemingly quite different, but in fact intimately related discourse of what has come to be known as parametricism in architecture, building defined only by what has been termed by Patrick Schumacher their relationality to abstracted variables of geometry, form, and environment. But I'm not actually here to argue for the inadequacy of digital solutions to complex problems of city and ecology. And in fact, my aim is, in some measure, to argue the reverse. Because against the increasingly certain uncertainty of climate change and its unpredictable catastrophic effects on traditional infrastructure, and against the rapid urbanization of the planet, in which as much urban fabric will be hastily and often informally built in the next 35 years, as has been built in the last 10,000 years of human history, and against the fact that we also produce now as much data every approximately 48 hours as we did in the history of the world up until 2007, I think we have to think about how information and information processing tools can be used to create more sustainable landscapes and cities. So let's think about what that means. Let's think about what qualities in particular we might want to introduce into cities and landscapes at this particular historical moment, and how we might use information processing tools to get us there. Fundamental to the current discourse about urbanism and climate change are two words, I think you should always look at where words come from when you're trying to figure them out. And the first word is, of course, resilience, which comes from the Latin for springing back or recoiling, coming back to where you were before. And this etymology is part of why I don't actually think resilience is a very good word to talk about what we need to try to do with cities. Instead, I like to use the word robustness, which comes from the Latin robur or oak, and it is used often interchangeably with resilience to convey a notion of being able to both stay the same but also constantly change and adapt to circumstances. So whether robustness or resilience, my own work, a very important part of my work as a designer in the last 4 or 5 years has been focused on the development of digital tools to imagine not single design proposals, but networks of proposals, and in particular, the use of such tools to examine not singular central urban spaces, but landscapes of neglect, of the marginal, the forgotten, and the lost. The work is several years old, but has the caveat that it's still very much in its infancy. And with that, I'll show you the work. So I believe that it may be the case that as we seek to build robustness and resilience into human landscapes, one of the most essential opportunities might not be, very precisely not be, to seek ever more virtuosic systems of order and coordination, but rather to better engage disorder, disorganization, and the inevitable gap between the world as we imagine it and the world as it actually is. The work takes as its starting point an instrumental and unfinished project by Gordon Matta-Clark called Fake Estates or Reality Properties. And Gordon Matta-Clark, in the 70s, spent 3 or 4 years looking through phone books of properties owned by the city to locate and buy these 7 little marginal sites all around the landscape of New York. But nowadays, using the GIS, you can find up to 4,000. In fact, we're now working with 30,000 of these sites in New York in just a few minutes if you know what you're looking for. And so then the question is, having found such sites, what do you actually do with them? And they're not just unique to New York. If you look at many different American cities, here we have, San Francisco, Boston, New Orleans, Miami, you can find thousands of acres of vacant public, vacant and, as it's new called, technically underutilized public land. So the first case study we did looked at 1,500 of such sites in San Francisco. And these are a very specific type of property called an unaccepted street. They're zoned as a right-of-way, but they're not generally used, and they're not maintained by the city. So these places are very precisely what Matta-Clark termed spaces between places. And if we use, again, a series of digital tools, they start to have a bunch of even more interesting qualities. So they tend to track very closely a variety of public health and environmental hazards throughout the landscape of the city. They tend to track very closely with reported crime, and then they tend to track very closely with a whole bunch of even more sophisticated social measures. They also track environmental hazards very closely, not only heat islands, but also in particular in San Francisco, impedances in the stormwater system and the location in the city of heavy particulate matter, cancer causing soot from vehicles and the like. So the project really is about what happens when you imagine all of these things together, not just conceived, but even potentially designed as a functional network. And the project at its core is a proposition about thinking very differently about infrastructure in the 21st century city. Not infrastructure as something we spend a whole bunch of money on once, on stuff that goes under the ground, but infrastructure is something that can and should be dispersed and networked and present in the landscape. If you take just half of the money that San Francisco has been spending on the upgrading of its stormwater system, for example, along with a bunch of other local and regional grants, and you instead target each of these sites with the amount of an amount of money that's proportional to the infrastructural work that each of these sites can do, you get to a number that approximates about $600 a square foot for each of these sites, which buys you an enormous amount of landscape and infrastructure, especially in part poor and underserved parts of the city. So what we do, of course, there are many people before me who have worked on the use of underutilized space as ecological infrastructure, and the only part that we really add to it with this project is the ability, by hacking together a whole variety of GIS and parametric design tools, to specifically look at a simulation, environmental simulation, of heat, air, light, and water on each individual site, and construct out of that a framework for what a design intervention might actually look like and how one would specifically array a whole range of materials and surfaces on the site to make another proposition. On top of that, of course, and this is the most undercooked part of the project that we're only just now really starting to work on, if you were to really imagine 1,500 or 5,000 or 30,000 interventions in the city, one would, of course, have to actually engage the city and citizens itself in a very substantial way to ensure that there is a level of ownership, engagement, and actual participation in the real sense, not just in the usual lip service sense, with how the thing actually took place. So I think I'll skip forward a bit. So in practical terms, this project has been, this is the work that's been shown at the various at various art and architecture biennials. It's also taken the form since that initial kind of proof of concept case study of a range of partnerships with nonprofit groups. We partnered in Los Angeles with a nonprofit called the Amigos de los Rios to look at sites like this one, sites leased by billboard companies throughout the LA LA County, sites leased for their proximity to highways and major avenues, and the billboard companies put up a billboard on it, but they tend to just use the land underneath it for surface parking or even just chain it off. And because of the nature of the geographic nature of both poor neighborhoods and hydrology in Los Angeles, these sites have a very similar quality to the sites in San Francisco of being very well suited both for environmental, for the provision of ecosystem services, and then also for the provision of public and open space to underserved neighborhoods. And out of this, we produced a range of about 800 proposals that the nonprofit has then since used in its actual fundraising and advocacy for the transformation of these sites. As part of the U.S. Pavilion at the 2012 Venice Architecture Biennale, we did a project in Venice. You might think that Venice has no abandoned spaces. Any of you who have been there, a city of 60,000 visited by 8 million tourists a year, there's very little space that seems like they're up for grabs. But it turns out that historically, Venice was not just this piece in the middle that Venetians call the fish, but it was the whole lagoon and a whole range of islands that had been mostly vacant since Napoleon ordered them vacated when he took over Venice in 1798. And all of these islands were historically part of the city, and they were particularly part of the city where the city accomplished a whole range of experimental things that couldn't be necessarily accomplished in the center. So we have done, did a whole range of proposals for these sites that also centered around how you conceive of a more productive ecology and economy in the very broken space of Venice. But I'll rush forward from that and also say that we're moving back to New York. This is one of Matta Clark's original fake estates, which we turned up in our own analysis. And now we're actually working with a team of urban ecologists at the New School to look at over 30,000 sites throughout New York City. And I'll show you a little bit more about that project at the end. How is all your stamina? Doing okay? Okay. Because, so this is one of the transitions back into the world of ideas. I think that, you know, I like this work a lot. It's what I spend a lot of time on. But work like this, particularly in the real landscape of cities, is just full of all kinds of problems. And it's very, very problematic to kind of imagine that the systems and models of a design technology can accurately address or approach the real complexity of social and political urban landscapes. So instead of just having you think that, I'm going to try and in some ways acknowledge that problem, but also engage some of the interesting historical threads that problem relates to, in particular in the work of Gordon Matta Clark. Central to Gordon Matta Clark's own view of urban design was the experience of his father, Robert Matta, who worked for 2 years in the studio of Le Corbusier before rejecting the master's work as being suitable only for a, quote, non-existent creature that lived in perfect harmony with society and work. Matta Clark traced his own interest in adaptive reuse to the observation that, quote, the availability of empty and neglected structures is a prime textual reminder of the ongoing fallacy of renewal through modernization. attempting to formalize the lessons of disordering, and in particular of Mata Clark, Rosalind Krauss and Yves-Alain Bois collaborated on an influential 1996 essay called A User's Guide to Entropy. In particular, several sections contributed by Bois consider the work of Mata Clark as being exemplary of what is called entropic practice. By ordering Mata Clark's work's collective disorder in successive scales, Bois first considers the artist's experiments shown here, very early in his career, right after he was an architecture student at Cornell, in layering and burning physical objects. These are this is a project called Photo Fry, which involved frying a Polaroid negative in a cast iron pan with oil and all kinds of other gross stuff, and then coating the result with a gold leaf. Bois then moves on to Mata Clark's famous cuttings and dismembering of buildings, which is a practice at its core of creative destruction, and concludes with an extended consideration of the fake estates. Bois consistently emphasizes what he calls the sovereign contempt in Mata Clark's attitude towards architects. Bois even adopts Mata Clark's own voice to do this. Quote, "What I do, you could never achieve, since that presupposes accepting ephemerality. Architecture has only one destiny, and that is, sooner or later, to go down the chute." One thing it's important to understand about this essay in this particular time period, it was not so much a historic reflection on Mata Clark as it was a particular battle in the conceptual war of architecture at the time. Because by this time, already, the clear failure of modernism's most strident social and urban claims led to a very explicit retreat to formalism, both initially to historicist so-called postmodernism, and then to an even stranger descendant, the so-called deconstruction of the mid-1990s, at which the User's Guide to Entropy essay was aimed very deliberately at a broadside. The story, it turns out, is very inseparable from Mata Clark's own.
It's fine, it does its
own. Okay. Should I take it as some kind of commentary? Many of Mata Clark's teachers at Cornell, where he studied from 1962 to 1968, were very influential in the new movement of deconstruction. And for all the architecture students in the audience, I'll point out someone here is a dean studio, which just shows. And show something. But what's even more interesting about all of Mata Clark's teachers at Cornell, who were in the vanguard of, am I doing that, or is it just technology is just upset? Okay. They went so far as to claim Mata Clark as a particular precedent in the cutting, slicing, and visual dismembering of buildings. If you go to the Philip Johnson Deconstructivist Architecture catalog from MoMA in 1990, the picture number 3 is Mata Clark's splitting. And so what happened, particularly in deconstruction, was a kind of sympathy between Mata Clark's activity of splitting and the particular operation of architectural software at the time. I don't know how many people in the audience are old enough to remember Form Z, or Form Z as it was called in Britain where I learned it. But fundamentally, the architectural software at the time was solid modeling, solid modelers. So you did these cutting, you did these Boolean operations. You made something, then you subtracted something from it. And so Mata Clark was kind of adopted and incorporated as a kind of figurehead or precedent for this work. The era was also grounded, as much even of parametric discourse in the present, in the particular claims of some kind of autonomous formal modernism, first explored by Cornell's Colin Rowe in the 1947 essay, The Mathematics of the Ideal Villa, in the Architectural Review, in which the work of Corbusier and Palladio was celebrated for sharing, quote, a common standard, a mathematical one. During his own lifetime, this was an ideology and focus held by Gordon Mata Clark in violent disregard, never more so when he destroyed the windows of Peter Eisenman's Institute for Architecture and Urban Studies with an air rifle. The act, he was invited to give an exhibit, and then he did this instead. And for Mata Clark, it was a destruction with a very specific purpose, which is to say that by destroying the windows of this quintessential kind of gallery and context of formalism. He was pointing out, if only to himself, the what he regarded as the explicit relationship between this kind of modernism and the previous kind of modernism, which was quintessentially signified in New York at the time by these broken window housing projects of the kind of modernist Title I utopia. And yet, if we accept the assertion, I think rightly so, that Mata Clark's work was anathema to its deconstructionist appropriation, rightly so, especially given the artist's own statement on the subject, quote, "These were the guys I studied with at Cornell. These are my teachers. I hate what they stand for." We can nevertheless find some really interesting evidence of the architect's renewed of Mata Clark's interest in more alternative modes of architectural practice at the time of his death. I should have asked, you guys all know who Gordon Mata Clark is, right? He's still pretty well known in architecture schools. Okay, just checking. One of Mata Clark's last unfinished works was the physical construction of a community center on an unused site in Manhattan's Lower East Side, for which he was preparing construction work when he passed away in 1978. It was, in fact, funded by the Guggenheim Foundation. Mata Clark described the audience for the community center proposal as, quote, "a network of community groups and individuals engaged in open space and rehab projects, sweat equity, community gardens, play lots, cultural events, alternative living structures, etc., adding that the proposal had, quote, "brought these groups together." Mata Clark's use of the word network is also very interesting. At the same time as his design work engaged more and more with the real and social fabric of cities, Mata Clark also became intrigued by what was at the time the state of the art in digital practice. Just before his death, the artist wrote to both MIT and UCLA requesting the use of digital architectural mapping and visualization software, declaring that the use of computers was to become, quote, "the central part of my search to chart and reoccupy space." Now today, much of contemporary digital design adopts a network language. We were talking about this even earlier today, particularly that of complex non-hierarchical natural systems, words like emergence, morphogenesis, phylogenesis, et cetera, et cetera. Here it might be especially important to remember that one of the earliest critics to connect such biological theories of emergence with urban design was, like Mata Clark himself, a close student of Manhattan. When, in the last chapter of her 1961 book, The Death and Life of Great American Cities, itself called The Kind of Problem a City Is, activist and critic Jane Jacobs sought to articulate a metaphor for urban design distinct from the, quote, Corbusian collection of file drawers she abhorred, she took up the resonance, the intellectual resonance of her own history, in particular between her own unfinished undergraduate studies at Columbia, begun in her mid-20s, in which she specialized in both economics, but also more centrally, embryology and evolutionary theory. Connecting this to recent work at the Rockefeller Foundation, which had provided her with a series of grants to complete the book. At the Institute, the recently retired director, Warren Weaver, had specifically identified new thinking in the natural sciences describing what he called, or was the first to call, organized complexity. Quoting heavily from Weaver's essay, Jacobs makes a case, in this chapter I'm talking about, for the special affinity between urban landscapes and biological systems. Presenting the example of a single urban park, she submits that any attempt to isolate the many variables leading to the success or failure of such an urban enterprise is inherently dubious, for such variables are too numerous, too interconnected, and too fundamentally incalculable. Now, the Rockefeller Foundation's subsequent funding played a catalytic role in today's interdisciplinary discussions of emergent form, and in particular, of the 17 Nobel Prize winners in the natural sciences from the 50s to the 1960s, I think up to 15 of them were actually funded by Warren Weaver, very specifically around this idea of natural complexity. And much of this work went into the connection that architects always adore between the code of life, its DNA, and the way things actually turn out. But it turns out that the apparently coded and constructed qualities of biological systems may just turn out to be just that, which is to say, apparent. Because recent work in evolutionary biology has specifically underlined a new understanding that relationships between genetic contact, content, and resultant form between code and shape, far from occurring measurably, are in fact, just like the variables in a park, numerous, interconnected, and as Jacob said in that context, as slippery as an eel. However, if contemporary architects tend to overuse, or contemporary digital architects tend to overuse biological metaphors to buttress the notion of determinism and optimization in nature, the reverse has also historically been true, because few fields are in fact more littered with architectural language, misused architectural language often, than evolutionary biology, where notions like building blocks, blueprints, and the German word Bauplan or building plan, encouraged, especially in the 20th century, in the mid-20th century, a highly deterministic vision of nature itself. It was then, with some deliberate irony, that the late evolutionary biologist Stephen Jay Gould deployed an architectural metaphor to attack the foundations of such design-centric beliefs in evolution. In a seminal 1979 essay, Gould reasoned that under this then ubiquitous paradigm, the pendentives of San Marco, inaccurately called spandrels by Gould, should be best understood as a perfect adaptation. This is what I'm talking about here, as a perfect adaptation for the presentation of triangular paintings of angels. And the spandrels between the fan vaults at King's College Chapel, likewise, should be imagined to be a perfectly adapted device for the interleaving heraldry of Tudor crown and parliament, which if they, of course, are not. Instead, they share a quality with the islands of local code, an identity as a discovered and exploited leftover. And the useful exploitation of spandrels, as such moments are now termed in biology, is held to be responsible for such trivial evolutionary achievements as flight, the vertebrate skeleton, and human hearing. To this we might even add the manufacture of a spacesuit from a girdle. Now, regarding those who would ascribe a power of optimization to natural design in his own lifetime, even Darwin complained, quote, "Great is the power of steady misinterpretation." Most relevant to our own discipline in the time since Gould's essays, some of the most innovative work in evolutionary biology and complex systems has focused on the precise contribution of inaccuracy, inefficiency, and disarray to the very qualities of natural systems, which is to say their adaptiveness, robustness, and resilience, that our current architectural moment is probably most in need of. In evolutionary terms, such properties are especially unlikely to result, it turns out, from optimized singular designs, and instead result from what is termed rather delightfully a random walk through a landscape of adjacent possibility, where layers of use, reuse, and reappropriation overlap to buttress a system's resilience over time. It is a view of nature, then, that is pretty essentially and quite crucially urbane. And it includes even some much more recent work on which my current collaboration at SFI is concerned on the network nature of cities. I won't go too much into that, but I'll show some math, but this is a calculation which I love, which is that for, which I mentioned in the review this afternoon, that for a city of 1 million people, an effective simulation, network simulation, of what might actually happen when a specific object or plan is introduced, that calculation would take this many separate calculations to perform. That's 10 to the 6 times 10 to the 6th power, which is a number far greater than all of the atoms in the universe, and therefore fundamentally uncomputable. I'm only going to take a few more minutes of your time, because that is the end of the theory portion of the lecture. I'm going to show you I'm not trying to present a big answer to where this all leads. I'm trying to figure that out myself. But I'll show you a few things to do with the current state of the work of the urban work that I showed you. One thread of that ongoing work deals with the issue of representation. Here is the proposal for San Francisco, as was shown in installation at SF MoMA. These were many hundreds of individual proposals, CNC carved out of doors from abandoned buildings, which somehow seemed an appropriate way of trying to show both the spirit and the essence of the work. It also had, unlike a lot of the more architectural proposals that I showed you initially, these representations, I think, are more of what the representation of such a project needs to be, which is to say, far more open-ended and unspecific, and to do very quite essentially with the operation of the project at the urban scale, urban and infrastructural scale, and not so much with a specific formal idea of its actual execution. So that's very much the direction that the work, this work will be packaged into a book, which if I finish it, will come out this fall from Princeton Architectural Press, and the drawings in the book, this is, that was 1,500 drawings in my studio in Rome, are very much concerned now no longer with the physical form of the artifact, but very much with its infrastructural and environmental effect. The other very specific outcome of the proposal at the moment has to do with the proposal in New York, where we're and part of a much larger collaboration now with an urban ecology lab at the New School that has done a survey of these 30,000 sites in New York, and very specifically of the infrastructural and ecological capacity or promise of each site, with a whole stack of ecosystem services worked out at a far, far greater level of detail than certainly I ever could. And then that's leading to a very specific set of proposals that we are prototyping with a nonprofit called Green City Force, which uses AmeriCorps money to do urban greening of leftover parcels. So hopefully this will come together in a process of instrumenting and implementing work on individual sites. Here's some photos of people actually doing stuff. That will also then lead to a larger infrastructural proposal in a very real way in New York City. So now we're finished, or almost finished, but for symmetry, I want to show you at least one or two more angels. Wim Wenders' 1988 films Wings of Desire, or the Heavens of, or to give it its German title, The Heavens Over Berlin, was made 1 year before the fall of the Berlin Wall, when large areas of the city remained abandoned to history. In ponytails and helmet-length overcoats, two angels, Cassiel and Daimiel, who the latter ultimately relinquishing his immortality, listened to the thoughts of mortals, paying particular attention to the isolated, the estranged, the marginal, and the lost. In the visual language of the film, of course, the marginal spaces of the city play the central role, with the implication being that one can understand the most about a city or a society by that which it abandons. Now, of course, Berlin's lost spaces are lost to us, and with it some vital part of the city's history. Reclaiming what is marginal and interstitial without relinquishing its past presents much of our task as designers in this uncertain moment. And I thank you most of all for the chance to reflect on this a little bit with you tonight. Thank you very much. So even more than your applause, I would love to hear your questions or comments or thoughts. That's the most fun part for me. Yeah.
It would take a long time to ask questions on all these interesting things you said. With regards to disorder, that caught my attention, one of my things that caught my attention, and I was thinking of Peter Sennett's books, The Uses of Disorder, and that comes into play.
Oh, absolutely, No, I mean, I think that's very, you know, when we're talking about the city, those who have sought to optimize the city, you know, have historically been, you know, authoritarian, you know, the whole history of the city is about a struggle between, about a kind of balance that we see in many kinds of complex systems between order and disorder, between a kind of a special flexibility and robustness that happens on the edge of those two conditions. And so, you know, we think of our task as architects, especially in the city, as so often a task of ordering. Of you know, creating, of analyzing, producing diagrams that give structure to what is going on. But I guess part of what I'm trying to say, and you may have said it better than I, is that actually we should be equally equal or greater advocates of disorder and open-endedness and a kind of lack of determinism about how what we do, because the city has its own special kind of expertise and adaptability. And when we try to imagine that a building or a landscape will work in one specific way and only that way, we are only pretty much guaranteeing that it won't work in that way. Yet so much of our kind of the way we talk about designs, even and especially in architecture schools, has to do with imagining